playing during the middle of the show?
Possible. You want to close it real quick? Still got a second. Oh, somebody's coming in.
Ladybug, close the laptop over there.
Thanks, hon.
Yo, this is Deontay the Bronze Bummer Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom, for the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Hey. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. Yeah. I'm talking about the greatest. Yeah. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out one. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live episode of Real Fans Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. And the madness is upon us, ladies and gentlemen. And no, I'm not referring to Ladybug dancing on tables or me going crazy at her birthday party. I am referring to the NCAA tournament. And chances are your bracket is ruined already. As the game started earlier today, a lot to discuss in the world of sports. Before we get into that, let me introduce my co-host, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
First of all, I told you my bracket is perfect. Okay, it's perfect. It has not been ruined yet, all right? But I'm cheating, so don't even sweat that because I'm keeping it real with y'all. I didn't do my bracket just yet. I'm waiting until
So who'd you have in the Duke-Villanova game?
Oh, I had Duke, of course. But,
well, Duke wasn't playing Villanova, you know, and they didn't even...
Exactly.
You know, listen...
I
got to call you out on that perfect bracket.
I told you, I'm waiting until the Final Four, and then I'm going to fill out my bracket.
Okay, all right. That's a good strategy. That way... You know, you still got to get the last three picks right, though.
Listen, man, it's been a hectic week, man. They got me running around like crazy, you know, doing all this stuff, little odds and ends. So, you know, I didn't have time to get to my bracket, but it's all good because, you know, Duke is going to take the tournament this year anyway.
I actually do have Duke in my ESPN bracket.
But you usually do like five of them.
No, I do one for ESPN. I did one on Yahoo, and I did one on CBS.
So you're cutting down this year because you're kind of addicted to the
brackets. No. I wasn't thinking about not even doing it because I usually do like a whole bunch of research and think about each individual matchup and everything. Thing, who's gonna play who? I didn't do that this year, but you know, I always beat Obama with his bracket, but he's not president anymore, so I guess the motivation was gone. Like, I gotta beat Obama and his bracket.
Yeah. And Trump said he wasn't doing the brackets.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, Obama was into basketball. Yeah, that's true. You know.
He was a baller, though. Obama was definitely a baller. Trump is more into business and that kind of stuff. So, you know, can't be too mad. But I mean, you want to see the president's pick. You know,
it's always good to beat the president. And something.
Yeah, exactly. You know, feel good about yourself. But, you know, it is what it is. It's all good. He's not into it. So, you know, whatever. Like I said, you know, I'm pulling for Duke as usual. I'm just hoping Grayson Allen, he's not tripping people on the way to the Final Four. I'm going to need him to play a clean game of basketball, you know, throughout this tournament. But I think they got a good chance. I'm happy that, you know, Coach K, who had to take off some time early in the season with the back issues, I'm glad that he's back. And I think Duke is coming forward again this year. They getting hot at the right time. You know, had a couple of, you know, little injuries, little tic-tac injuries, a couple of suspensions with Grayson Allen. But I do think that they're back now. They had a big win, you know, against North Carolina the other day. Over at the Barclay, they won again, you know, in the ACC tournament.
They might play each other in the finals, the way the brackets are set up.
That would be crazy if that happens. If that happens, you know, me and Sean Fontaine ain't going to be able to speak for a couple of weeks. If that goes down, you know, he's a big North Carolina fan. But I'm looking forward to the tournament. I can sit back a little bit and enjoy some of the games now that things have kind of cooled off. But who you taking to win it all? I know you said you got Duke on one of your brackets.
Yeah, that's the first one I filled out. I mean, you got Duke, you got, North Carolina's a number one seed. Gonzaga's a number one seed, but I don't think they're really going that far. I mean, UCLA with the ball, I think that's a possibility. But I always like Louisville to make it to the Final Four at least. That defense on Louisville, great coaching with that full court press, it really wears teams down. So yeah. Louisville's always a big one to watch out for. But if I had to pick one, I'd actually go with Duke this year. Not to agree with you. I mean, I was filling out the bracket, and I'm like, Duke might actually win. So, I mean, Kentucky's a powerhouse too. So, I mean, but it's not a sure thing for any team this year, that's for sure. So.
I got you. Now Statman, you mentioned Lonzo Ball. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna go a little bit off topic, just a little bit, because
we're still on.
I sat down, with some friends, and I was just, I've been so disgusted with the Knicks, mm-hmm. pretty much since I was probably two, because they just haven't won since then. Now, but I was coming up with strategies, and I think
when you were two, they didn't win either. Technically,
that's what I'm saying. So I was,
I mean, they won, but they didn't win all championships.
That's what I'm saying. So I said, you know what, for Statman, I'm gonna take this upon myself to help fix the Knicks organization.
Okay.
And this is what I came up with, Statman. I think you'll like this. Okay. What I think that James Dolan needs to do. Okay. He needs to go back, apologize to Patrick Ewing, bring Patrick Ewing back in to help Kristaps Porzingis develop, get to work on that offensive game. Then, you'll help out with the fan appreciation, the customer relations and whatnot, because you're bringing back the greatest Nick of all time to help out with the organization again. Now, that's the first part. Second part is, you don't even like Melo, so this won't even bother you. You got to some way, shape, or form, trade Melo so that you can get Lonzo Ball in the draft. And then you'll have your point guard.
I don't know if anyone would really do that.
I'm coming up with suggestions. I'm trying to help you out here, Steph.
I know, but I'm just saying,
I'm coming up with suggestions.
I don't know if a team would do that. And plus, the big thing is Melo has the no trade clause. Like, that's he's not going to go to a team that has the number one pick or a top pick. So.
Well, I mean, the number one pick could still be the Celtics. I'm sure he would go to the Celtics.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
At this point, so if you could do that. Now you got your point guard, and you got one of the better big men in the league, both young. Neither one of them is over 24 years old. You got a good 10 years out of each of those guys. Knicks could look pretty good if they did those things.
All right. If they win out their last 14 games, they could still technically make the playoffs, too. For the Knicks fans out there, since he brought up the Knicks are in 12th place right now, 27-41. The Pistons and the Heat are 33-35, so they are 6 games behind the 8th seed right now.
Now, I feel bad because that, man, going into the season, I was real gung-ho about this, man.
I was gung-ho about them being 4th or 5th. You look at the lineup, but it's not always the case.
And now we can't even get 9th or 10th, and they're struggling for that. And I really thought it was going to be, Knicks, Cavs. And this is my fault, because I gave them way too much credit. The Knicks do not deserve that much credit, because they suck. So, next time, I can't even give the Knicks that kind of credit. I'm just going to say, they'll hang around 10th place. That's if the Knicks get to 10th place in the East, I'll be happy for them.
The Knicks are and still are the only 8th seed in the history of the playoffs to make it to the NBA Finals. So
that is a fact.
They might turn things around. Phil Jackson was out there, doing the triangle with the point guards.
He was.
They pulled out a win the other night.
He definitely was. Hornacek is getting behind him. He says, that'll attract some free agents this summer. I don't know how true that is, but and I don't even know how I feel about Phil stepping coming in and trying to run a triangle with the team. You know, I mean, like, you're not even doing a good job as GM.
Desperate times call for desperate measures.
Yeah, but if he was doing a good job as GM, I can understand that. But he's not even doing his job.
Well,
right.
his job is supposed to be a coach. Like, that's what he should have done in the first place. Pat Riley was a GM and a coach at the same time. That's what Phil Jackson should have done. But he's getting up there in age, and he wants to not have to deal with the traveling and all that other stuff. And, you know, I mean, people didn't like the idea of him coaching the home games and not the away games. But I would have taken that.
Yeah. Well, because you know what? He'd still be working with the team on a, you know, on a day-to-day. So, you know, everything that they're going over in practice, he's pretty much just going to have the assistants, you know, reinforcing that if they're on the road. And that's it. Once Phil sets the tone of what the mindset of the team is, how they're going to function, how they're going to, you know, what they're going to do on offense, what they're going to do on defense, that's pretty much all you need, because you are putting these assistant coaches in place and they're pretty much underneath your tutelage anyway. So they're going to run whatever it is that you say that you want to run. So it could have actually worked. I mean, it's a little too late for that now.
Not necessarily. Six games behind.
We shall see, Statman.
I mean,
for
a Knicks fan, you're you know, a little hopeful. I mean, the press, you know, they interview Porzingis after the win. They're like, you don't have a realistic chance of, you know, making it to the playoffs and winning here at the Garden anyway, and et cetera. I'm like, I looked at the math. I was like, what are they talking about, a realistic chance? You're talking about six games behind with 14 games to go. That's not impossible. Yeah, you could really win, you know, 10 out of 14, which is realistic, and still probably squeeze in. You got the Bulls in 10th place. Dwayne Wade is out now.
He's done for the season.
So, I mean, the Pistons,
but you know what,
and
Porzingis,
the Heat.
You know, he keeps getting these little ticky-tack injuries, though, that's keeping him out. Yeah. Missing the game here, missing the game.
I mean, I'm not trying to give the Knicks fans too much hope here. I mean, you know, the odds, I wouldn't bet the farm that the Knicks are going to make the playoffs at this point. Obviously, it's a long shot, but it's still possible.
I wouldn't bet anything that the Knicks would make the playoffs at this point.
I wouldn't bet the penny in my pocket.
Yeah, it's over for that dream.
I don't even think I have a penny in my pocket, to be honest.
Because probably because you bet on the Knicks before today. That's why you don't have no money. Stop betting on them, Stan.
I don't bet on the Knicks, man. I know that. That's you know, bet with your head, not with your hate or your heart. Yeah. I usually say hate, but heart too. You know, you don't do that. You don't bet on New York sports in general. You just never know with anybody.
Yeah, you know what I mean.
Unless this is Giants against the Patriots in the Super Bowl, that's pretty much a sure thing.
Yeah, you can take that to the bank. I'm 100% with you on that one. You did mention Dwayne Wade is out for the season, got the elbow injury, which kind of sucks. But you know what, I'm surprised he actually lasted as long as he did, because I knew once he went to Chicago, I knew he was going to have to do a lot in order for them to be good, which means, you know, more pressure on Dwayne Wade. So I'm surprised he held up the way he did, you know, so far. That's why, you know, I was thinking a team maybe could have went to the Cavs or the Spurs, one of those teams where it wouldn't have to be on Dwayne Wade as much. But when you pretty much have Jimmy Butler and Dwayne Wade, I mean, because they brought Rondo in, but he played horrible this season. You know, now you have to do more, and when you're doing more, that's when those injuries, you know, start catching up to you. So, you know, but he is done for the season. So, I don't know about the Bulls anymore either. They're probably out of there.
Well, Obama wouldn't be happy about that one, that's for sure. But,
I mean, you know, that's his squad. But, you know, it is what it is. He is done. So it's all on Jimmy Butler if he can make things happen for the team.
Yeah, not very likely. But in other news in the NBA, speaking of injuries, Aldridge was cleared after the heart arrhythmia. Obviously, they take heart issues very seriously. They don't want people, you know, dying on the court, which we've seen happen in basketball.
Chris Bosh.
And, Bosh didn't die. You know,
well, you know what, but as far as, them taking it serious with the heart issues.
Yeah.
I'm happy he's back, though. I'm definitely happy he's back. Because, you know, when you have to miss playing time for something like that, like, that's not an injury on the court. You break a knee or a foot or whatever. That's something that you really can't do anything about. And as much as you might want to play, they're not.
I mean, he's a you know, healthy person. So, I mean, for the most part. And then, you know, it's not a knee thing or something where you could do rehab or whatever. So it's something life-threatening. It's out of your control, and it's really rough. And especially when you're, you know, not like, you know, Dwayne Wade, who's not on a real contender. You got you know, a legitimate chance of winning it all on the Spurs, who are actually only one game behind the Warriors at this point. And with the Warriors not having Durant, who do you think takes the West now? It used to, was a little bit of a clear-cut shot for the Warriors there. Now Durant's out. Aldridge is going to be coming back. Do you think the Spurs take first place?
Yeah, I'm definitely going with the Spurs to take first place, but don't be surprised if Houston, you know, sneaks up there as well. You know what I mean? Because
still,
like, we saw
a little far behind on third place there.
Last,
I think they're
night,
5.5.
You know, we saw the Spurs lose last night. I mean, Golden State, they've been kind of on a roller coaster since Durant went out. I mean, losing to the Celtics by 15 in Golden State, losing to the Timberwolves. They almost lost to the 76ers the other night. You know, they've had to fight to get back into. They were down by 14 in the fourth quarter, managed to squeak out a 2-point victory against the Sixers. I mean, and we're talking about the Sixers without Joel Embiid. Not that, I mean, he makes really that much of a difference on that team, but a Sixers team without their best player, and you're only able to win by two, and you're down pretty much the whole game.
They also sat out a primetime game. Curry,
the Spurs game they sat out, but I mean, that game the Spurs didn't have Aldridge, Parker, or Kawhi Leonard because he had the concussion.
I mean, that was
the battle of the bums.
Yeah,
on each team.
I mean, you have a primetime game, and you know all the stars on both teams for the 1 and 2 seed in the West. That's a game that people, you know, want to see.
Yeah, and I thought that the league could have maybe switched to put a different game on in prime time once they knew all of these guys were going to be out. But, I mean, because, I mean, we pretty
at,
much watched
the same
Pound
time, when you, when you think of, you know, the ticket pricing for a matchup like that, you're going to pay, you know, prime money to for that matchup.
Yeah.
And then you're going to go and see. That's why a lot of people have a problem with this going on in the league. But is there anything Stern could do about it?
He can't, because, I mean, this is all strategy, okay? Like, you know, people complain, you know, LeBron takes a night off. But it's not just LeBron. It's the entire league. Everyone does this. I mean, Popovich has been doing it for years with his guys. Now we're seeing it with the Warriors. I mean, these teams, you know, older veteran teams that are going to go deep into the playoffs, this is part of the game strategy because, I mean, these guys, I mean, you got to look at Golden State, who's going to been to the finals 2 years straight. That's a lot of mileage. Then the Olympics in between that. Same thing with the Cavs. Went to the finals 2 years straight. The Spurs go deep into the playoffs every year. You know what I mean? You know, so all of these teams that go deep into the playoffs, yeah, that's a part of their strategy now. This is the new age strategy.
But if I'm a fan, I'm gonna look at this game, a big matchup game, in advance and say, am I gonna pay for these tickets?
And then they not be.
And then I'm not gonna take that risk, and that's gonna affect the dollars. And there's really nothing you could do about it, because even if you know you want to go and put a rule in where, unless if you're medically cleared to play, then you have to, you know, suit up. The coach could suit him up on the roster and just keep him on the bench, because you can't tell a coach that he has to play a certain player.
That's the thing. And you know, and majority of fans are not going to have that mindset going into buying tickets. So that's the thing that really sucks. It's like when you're, as a fan, you're just thinking, oh, great, Miami's playing Cleveland.
What comes to mind, because, you know, the Miami fans, they want to see LeBron come back to Miami, but he sits out those games.
And it's like, what are you going to do? But, you know, you don't think, you know what, LeBron's probably not going to play this game. Well, he might not, because then,
I'm going to wait till the last minute and buy the tickets,
aftermarket,
and, you know, but then you pay more if they do play. I mean, it's just, you know.
Well, at least they did. You know, they had the family at the Spurs-Warriors game. It was, you know, the big story how they spent all this money for everybody to get tickets to the game because they were Golden State fans. And the Warriors were supposedly taking them into the locker room after the game to get autographs and hang out with the team for a little while, which is dope. But, I mean, we can only do that for one. Like, I mean, are you going to do that for every fan who missed out?
You got over 20,000
people. And how do you decide who gets who's the fan that's going to get to see the players have a little meet and greet? So, but you know what? Maybe that might be actually something that they could do to incorporate it, if there's big games like that where the stars sit out, is maybe have a meet and greet, like a mandatory meet and greet with the players, so that at least the fans could, you know.
You can't mandatory do that, I don't think. Like, I mean.
I mean, I'm trying to help, the, you know, customer relations. I'm coming up, you know. I'm bringing this up the top of the dome right now. I don't know what's going on with the NBA, but I know it sucks as a fan. I know
you get to see them sitting on the sidelines, and that's about it.
I know if I bought tickets to a Knicks or a Nets game because they were playing the Cavs and LeBron sat out, I know I'd be tight as a fan. Good. So, you know what I mean? So, I know it sucks. Like, what are you going to do about it? And I also understand, like, this is the strategy. That's what basketball has become. Like, certain guys are going to be rested certain games, especially as they get older. And it's always going to be the top players in the, you know, in the league. You know what
as,
I mean?
As our interview with the late, great Anthony Mason, you know, the league is going soft. Like, you know, and he was talking about that on his years before he retired. Like, people sitting out because their toe hurt and,
exactly.
You know, stuff like that. So, I mean... You know, when he came from a winning mentality and then goes and sees teams that, you know, they're not playing because,
yeah,
you know, like, oh, you're not playing, you hurt. And they're like, no, I'm fine. I just, you know.
I had a little sneeze this morning. So I'm sitting this morning. So I stubbed my toe. I got a hangnail. I can't play for 3 weeks, man.
Yeah. Back in the old days, speaking of which, we got, you know, somebody who thinks that he could be MJ, you know, Ball's dad, LeVar. So we're going to take a fan mail question. Jeremy from Queens, right? If they actually set it up, who would win in a one-on-one game, Charles Barkley or LeVar Ball?
Now, all right. First of all, and let me say this to LeVar Ball. In the words of Madea, sat down, Brown. Okay, sat down. You need to chill, bro. You need to chill. Don't you ever in your life call out the greatest of all time, Michael Jordan, talking about you could beat Michael Jordan in a game on one-on-one basketball. Because if you could beat Michael Jordan in a game of one-on-one basketball, we'd know who you are. And 99.999% of the world did not know who you were prior to 2 months ago. Mm-hmm. So let's knock that off.
That's because of your son and exactly. You talking all that trash.
Yeah, that has nothing to do with you. Now, back to the, you know, to you playing one-on-one with Charles Barkley. I mean, Charles Barkley is out of shape right now. I don't know exactly what he's capable of. LeVar Ball does look like he's definitely in better shape than Charles Barkley. So I don't know. But you know what? Barkley, you know, got the, you know, he was is a Hall of Famer. I'm sure he still got a little bit left in the tank. He might be able to post him up. So I don't know on that one. I'm kind of, you know, in between on that.
You know, backtracking a bit with Jordan, obviously he's in his 50s now.
I think Jordan would beat him right now, though.
Oh, 100%.
I think Jordan would still
Jordan stopped, you know, he used to beat the players on Charlotte.
Yeah.
And he
and we're
stopped,
talking about 3 years ago.
Yeah, and this is recently. Yeah. And he is in his 50s. So, and he stopped playing the players because he felt it ruined their ego that somebody in their 50s is beating them. So Jordan can still play. And when you talk about the last thing that goes is the jump shot, you know, obviously Jordan didn't lose his shot if he's beating people at his age now.
Exactly.
And Barkley was not just a post-up. He had a jump shot. He had a three-pointer. He wasn't a great three-point shooter, but he had range. He wasn't just you know, post him up, big man. You know, he's known for his rebounding.
I'm only giving him a chance against Barkley. I'm saying as a toss-up for me just because I know Barkley is not in playing shape right now.
Yeah, but at the same time, like, you know, you could be overweight and still have a jump shot.
Yeah,
and
you're absolutely right. You know what I mean? You're absolutely right. That's my only reason. I just, you know, I don't know, you know, how as far as, because remember, it's not even just about making them shots. You still got to run around on that court, too.
Now,
so I don't know how stamina is.
Would happen in this one-on-one? Like, where would it be a pay-per-view thing? Would it be
that's what
on
I'm
the
saying.
Internet?
I don't
would it
know.
Be on, I mean, I guess it would be on TNT, because that's,
yeah,
you
know. Yeah, it got to be on TNT. But now, because, I mean, they could do a little half-court in the studio.
That's what I was thinking.
Put
just
the court
now
up and let them go at it.
Or they could do it here at Real Fans Real Talk. We got to just get the net and everything, so they're going to have to fund that.
We could, yeah, I mean, listen, we could do it here, you know, talking maybe Spalding.
And I got winner. I got winner because I got to show off my skills. You talk about out of shape. I got a little fat on me, but I didn't lose my J either.
I got you, Statman.
I'm down,
you know?
40 pounds, too, for the year. So,
all right, so then, listen, we got to keep
ready
that
I'm
going.
Ready to ball out there.
All right. But well, shout out to I'll take you versus LeVar Ball's dad. Be honest with you, I would take you. If he called you out,
you know the skills.
Exactly.
You know
if he called
skills,
you out, I would have went with you, and I would have bet on you, too. You know what I mean? I believe in the,
In
the game.
I'm sure not more than like 50 cents.
Nah, not that much. Probably a quarter. I can do a quarter bet. You know how to do the quarter bets? I do the quarter bets.
Well, that makes sense. I don't want you to lose.
You're still my boy.
I don't want you to have to take out a loan after, you know, that betting with your heart, betting with your hate thing.
But you know, we got to support the home team.
Of course, 100%. A quarter is good, though. I appreciate the faith. Shout out to Jeremy from Queens for writing in.
Queens, what up? Jamaica Southside, Hollis by the Hero Shop. What's up?
Fanmail at realfansrealtalk.com is the email address. You can hit us up on social media, Twitter and Instagram at realfantalk and facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Hit the like button on that. You can send us a message on Facebook. We do respond to our fans, and we do appreciate all you fans out there. But getting to the brackets, the big upset is so far as Middle Tennessee beating Minnesota. That's the 12th seed, so that's everybody's brackets being gone. Northwestern got the victory. That's their first... first time in the big dance, and they come out and beat Vanderbilt in the first round.
I mean, one and done?
One and done?
Northwestern, I'm saying they got in for the first time in how long? It was ever. So they in there.
Yeah.
They won one game. I mean, that in itself is an accomplishment.
I mean, Kansas Kansas has the record for most big dance appearances this year. And they're a top.
So they probably
as well.
They definitely got more wins than they've got appearances.
And shout out to Rose Claire, who's in Kansas. Maybe we'll have her on live via satellite. In the studio, former correspondent of Real Fans Real Talk. Mm-hmm. But getting back to the NBA though, we talked about the Aldridge injury. Kevin Love could be back within the week now. Obviously, it's a biased question, but with Love back, does that make them the favorite again to win it all?
Well, I mean, I thought they were the favorite to win it all.
Even without Love?
Oh, no. Not without Love. I don't think they're the favorite to win it all. I think they'll still go back to the finals without Kevin Love. But, you know, when Love is in the lineup, I think they're the favorite to win it, especially, you know, with Durant being out. I thought it was... It was kind of even, you know, in my opinion, before Durant went out, you know, and then the Cavs, you know, added Darren Williams, which I thought was a great pickup for them. I mean, you know, I would like to have seen Bogut a little bit longer than a minute, they did bring in...
He got his 1 minute of fame.
Yeah,
they
did bring on Larry Sanders.
He can't get the ring.
You know, they sent him down to the D League to kind of get back into playing shape, so hopefully he'll be ready, you know, come playoff time. But, yeah, Love coming back. I mean, you got to look at the Cavs as the favorite. I mean, LeBron James is playing amazing right now. You know what I mean? He's not on his Westbrook triple-double, but he's got like 10 triple-doubles on the season. I mean, he does it all, you know. And then you got Kyrie, who's an amazing, amazing player who was getting better every night. And you bring back, you know, Josh Smith is finally back. You know, once Kevin Love comes back, and then they can really, because you got to think right now, they don't have their complete chemistry yet because all these guys have been out at the same time. So now, you know, they brought in Darren Williams, but now Kyle Korver is out. He had a little foot issue, so you got to bring him back. Kevin Love has been out, so none of those guys, you know, Darren Williams, Kyle Korver, or Derek Williams.
Do you think we'll have a healthy Cavs team come playoff time?
Yeah, I do. I think we'll be good, you know, for the start of the playoffs. I think they're probably going to limit Kevin Love's minutes the rest of the season, but, you know, just enough to really get him in the groove of things. And I think, you know, once they get to the playoffs, no, you know, back-to-back games, I think they'll be fine. You know, I don't think they'll run into too much trouble in the Eastern Conference. I just don't think there's any team in the East that can go seven games with the Cavs right now. So I don't think they'll run into trouble in the East. And, you know, once they get to the finals, you know, whether it be Golden State, you know, I think they can beat Golden State. I think they can beat the Spurs, you know, which is crazy because I would have given them more of a chance, the Spurs more of a chance against the Cavs last year with Tim Duncan, but now that Tim Duncan is not there anymore, even though he was older, you know, last year, just, you know, just something about having Tim Duncan on the court with the rest of those guys, it makes the Spurs a scarier team. I mean, they're scary now. They're still really good, but I would still take the Cavs.
Paul Gasol is the new addition over there.
Yeah,
I mean,
but he's no Tim Duncan.
Yeah, but
and he's really good. I don't want to take anything away
Tim
from Gasol.
Tim Duncan versus Paul Gasol now, you know,
It's more so for me, it's more so the presence of Tim Duncan and what he means when he's on the court. And I think, you know, that because of, you know, his leadership that he has,
But, I mean, you still have, you know, the other veterans on there. You have one of the greatest coaches of all time.
Listen, they do.
Actually, you know, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if the Spurs won it all, to be honest with you.
I wouldn't be surprised either. You know what I mean? Like, they're a team that can actually win, you know, honestly. Even, you know, and as good as Houston is playing right now, I don't see Houston winning in the playoffs. I don't see them, you know, going to the finals. As good as they're playing, as good as James Harden, I think James Harden is the MVP. I mean, he was, you know, on the downside, but he completely just took his you know, career to a whole nother level this season, leading the league in assists, the way he's facilitating on the court. And, I mean, who else is on the team that you know what I mean? Who you could really say is a top player? It's just James Harden and D'Antoni.
I mean, we've seen it with LeBron and AI, being a one man show, making it to the big dance, you know,
but
the finals,
to actually win
it.
And that was with them not having to go through the Spurs or this Golden State Warriors team to get to the finals.
Yeah.
You know?
As a three seed, they'd have to most likely go through both.
Exactly.
In order to make it
and
to the finals.
That is going to be rough.
If they do that, then I think they could beat the Cavs,
too.
Oh,
well, now, if they go through the Golden State and the Spurs, you know what? No, actually, if they did that, then I don't think they would beat the Cavs because of the fact that that's going to be 2 7-game series, and it's going to be grit, iron, tooth and nail. You're going to be going at it with those teams. I mean, we saw the game earlier this season where Harden hits the shot to win the game against Golden State. You know what I mean? Like, but they were going at it. So now you're talking about a 7-game series back and forth, and then you got to go up against now whichever one you play first. You play the Spurs first or you play the Warriors first. It's still no easy task.
If the Spurs do, go to first place, they'll be playing – you know, the Warriors in the second round, most likely.
Yeah.
And, you know, Kevin Durant has to be back by the second round in order for them to win. Because I don't think...
Oh, yeah, no.
I don't think that if they don't get the one seed and they have to play the Spurs or the Rockets in that second
Honestly,
round...
Honestly, I don't know if they beat the Rockets in the second round without Durant.
I don't think so at all.
Yeah. For them to be struggling the way they are right now without Durant, and you have Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, and Draymond Green, excuse me, and you're losing to the Timberwolves, you barely beating the 76ers, you getting beat down and home. You know, I don't think they can beat Houston without Kevin Durant. You know, and it sucks. But it's like, you know, everything you gave up to get Durant, so it's like now you don't have Durant and you don't have all of those pieces. And, you know, Steph Curry is not having the greatest of years. He's playing well, but, I mean, we've seen as of late, you know, that three-point percentage, I mean, I've seen 1 for 9 nights, 1 for 10 nights,
yeah,
2 for 10 nights.
He's definitely on a slump right now.
Yeah, so if he does not step his game up, they're going to be in trouble.
You think part of Steph Curry falling off is the fact that, you know, Kevin Durant came on the team and he wasn't top dog anymore?
No, because it's not like, you know, Steph didn't have a great finals this year. And last year he didn't have a great finals. That's why Iguodala was wound up being the MVP. So this is not something that just happened because Durant got there. Because it wasn't, you know what I mean? Like, he started from the finals last season. If anything, it should have helped him.
Well,
that Durant,
I mean, he was playing with an injury last year, so, but...
Well, he's not playing with injury this year.
No,
so, you know, but I would think, you know, Durant coming in would make it easier for him because everybody has to be double teamed. I mean, you know, not necessarily Draymond Green, but you got Klay and Steph, two of the best shooters. Durant, the third best shooter in the league. So all of those guys have to be guarded. So somebody's going to be open at some point. So you think it'll be easier. But even when Durant was there, Steph was having 1 for 10 nights, 2 for 9 nights. You know what I mean? So if they don't get it together and figure something out, you know, I don't know, maybe he better talk to Ray Allen and get his shooter's touch back or something. But, you know, I don't see them beating the Rockets in the 7-game series without Durant. because they're not going to have that defense. And James Harden is pretty much doing whatever he wants. You know what I mean? Every night he's getting the shots that he wants. He's facilitating the way he wants to. And that team of guys you never even heard of are looking, you know, really great.
So James Harden, hands down MVP this year, right?
Yeah, I got to give it to them. You know, and we spoke about this earlier in the year. I said, what's going to stop Westbrook for me getting MVP is his team. It's going to be at the bottom. And if you look at James Harden and Russell Westbrook's team, the reason why, even if Westbrook winds up averaging a triple-double, the reason why I'm still going James Harden, because they both have similar teams. It's pretty much just them.
Yeah.
And a bunch of, you know, and if anything, you know, I said earlier in the year, when we had Eric Sanchez, our blogger, I said I thought Westbrook had the better teammates around him. Because you got Cantor, you got Steven Adams, you got Oladipo. I mean, who does James Harden have on the team with him? I mean, Patrick Beverley, you know, he's a really good defender at that guard position. But you know, I mean, Nene is old now. Trevor Ariza, yeah, he's a champion, you know, with the Lakers, but he's old now. So they both kind of had similar teams, but he manages to have his team, you know, in third place in the West, which is not easy to do. On top of that, and then, you know, with Westbrook, yeah, Westbrook is, you know, averaging double-digit assists, but for Westbrook to get those double-digit assists, what he's doing, you know, it's just crazy.
If they switch teams, would the OKC be in third place?
With James Harden on OKC,
yeah.
I have to say yes.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean,
they might even be higher because he'd have more support. He'd
exactly.
have the big man there and OKC.
A couple of shooters, yeah, a couple of decent big men. So, yeah, we might actually be talking about the Rockets getting first place, you know, with Durant. I mean, yeah, with OKC getting first with Durant being out. But, yeah, you know, it's a big accomplishment to average a triple-double for the season. Hasn't been done since Oscar Robertson. But, when your team is, what are they, in seventh place right now? In the West, and you got James Harden with...
Towards the bottom, I think seven.
James Harden with pretty much the same, if not worse, talent, and he's got that team in third place, you got to go James Harden, whether he gets that triple-double for the season or not.
100% in agreement with that. Switching topics to football, Darrelle Revis dropped of all charges. He had the assault case, so the case was a little shady because nobody actually witnessed... Revis hitting the guy, and his friend kind of stepped up and said that he was the one that did it. So a friend took the blame for it.
No, damn it. So I like that because you know this is how it's supposed to be. You know the breadwinner is even if and I know this is bad, but even if the breadwinner was the one that did it, but if the number one guy on your roster on your team outside of you know the game, I mean, if he get in a little trouble, he's supposed to take the hit on that, and then he's supposed to take care of you after that.
Probably not supposed to wait that long.
Yeah, well, exactly. You know, they have to wait till after you get cut by the Jets and all that, and then step in and say, you know, it was me. It would have been nice if you had said that from the jump, but maybe the check didn't clear. I don't. You know, who knows that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I appreciate the fact that, you know, he was ride or die right there, took one for the team, and stepped up to the plate and said that, you know, it was him and it wasn't Revis. But like you said, it would have been nice if he had said it when it first happened so that, you know, Revis's name wouldn't have been drugged through the mud the way it was. He might still be on the Jets roster, you know. But what are you going to do, man?
Well,
I'm just glad he's clear.
Revis said he wants to play where he's wanted.
Yeah.
I don't think that he'll be back in the Patriots uniform because after last season, I'm not sure if they would want him.
Not at all.
He'll definitely have a place in the NFL.
Patriots are snatching up every piece of good talent that's out right now.
Yep,
and I don't think Revis is on their radar anymore.
They traded their Super Bowl star for Brandon Cooks. Which is a top wide receiver. So you got Brady going there, and, you know, he's got a top target now.
Yep. He got that downfield threat that you know, so Brady's going to have fun this season. I wouldn't be surprised if the Patriots are back in the Super Bowl or if they win the Super Bowl.
Well, they might be going up against the Giants, who got the receiver themselves and Marshall, which we talked about last week.
They did, and they're starting to work on that offensive line, you know, as well. So, you know, we're going to wait and see. But, yeah. The Patriots are snatching up everybody, but we did mention the Eagles brought back Nick Foles.
We mentioned that pre-show to Cliff.
We like to give Cliff a little bit of cheer every once in a while, You know, he doesn't get too much with the Eagles.
Nick Foles did a good job when he was with the Eagles, so maybe the Eagles try something and like...
Maybe they'll do the Wildcat with Foles and Carson
That's
Wentz
like that backup quarterback. I'm drawing a blank on the Packers, who got the record for touchdowns, and then...
Matt Flynn.
And then disappeared afterwards. Like, your glory days are done, Foles.
that's pretty much it. But, you know, what are you going to do?
But, you know, I mean, the Eagles, they got to hope for something, you know.
That is true. That's very true. You know, I mean, you know, whatever. It's the Eagles. They suck. So, I mean, you know, let's just make sure everybody knows y'all watching Real Fans Real Talk on BPN 2. And make sure you guys are hitting us up on the web, realfansrealtalk.com, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk, Twitter, Instagram, @realfantalk, and subscribe to that YouTube channel, youtube.com/forthefansproductions. Ladybug is in the building. I just got a text just now. A couple of tweets came through threatening people and on the setup
here. They don't like it when Ladybug misses out.
So I'm not going, you know, I ain't going to wait too much longer, but I do got to shout out Math because, you know, I spoke to Math. He got a new video out right now. I tried to see, you know, if he had the clean version. He did not have the clean version, so I told him, Mav, don't worry about it. I got you. I'm used to this, you know, except my main man, Bobby Stone. Bobby Stone, the only one that don't give us no trouble, you know. And you know, Love Is On The Way. That's Mav's new joint. He's actually shooting another video this weekend. He asked the Real Fans Real Talk to come out, the team to come out and support. So we probably going to roll out and support him this weekend and, you know, in his next video shoot. But if you guys are ready, man, this is Mav Hoffa. Got a new joint now. I'm liking it too, man. Mature, grown man boss. Let's get that going. Whenever y'all ready. That's how we do it on Real Fans Real Talk. Recognize who y'all dealing with. Good, bro.
Pretty good.
Have a safe flight, kid.
Of course, man. Star, show me love, I show it to you too.
All right, we are back live on Real Fans Real Talk. Mark the Stat Man Skevich alongside Trip Young. And yes, you can relax, everyone, as usual, as promised. Ladybug is in the building. The one and only Ladybug. How you
doing? What's going on, guys? You know, every week is fun to be here. I always got the rumor mill. I have things going on. I have to let you guys know what's been happening. So, you know, I have to let these guys know they've been trying to dabble in my segments lately. Oh, if you guys been watching Real Fans, Real Talk, you know, they've been taking the rumor mill and been using it in the other segments. It's okay. You guys want me for the whole show, you guys can just write it in a memo. You ain't got to throw subs. It's okay. Anyway, on to the rumor, man. Well, not really a rumor. Definitely a big congratulations. And even though he's on the Cowgirls, you got to respect where credit, give credit where credit is due. Dak Prescott gets $353,000 performance bonus after the season is done. Like, that's a performance bonus. Like, and that's the compensation is based on the playing time percentage and the salary they receive. So, you know, they play the regular season at whatever salary, and then their playing time percentage adds to the bonus. And he got, like,
That's the thing.
Like, it's hard. It's hard to give full and genuine congratulations, but that's a nice amount.
I'm always for the check. You know, shout out to Dak Prescott on that. And he's very frugal, you know, with his money. You know, he don't like to be out too much and buying crazy stuff. So I'm sure that 350-something thousand is going to be right for him, you
especially
know.
Especially since he doesn't have a big contract as a rookie that wasn't expected to play at all.
Yeah, really. Exactly, basically.
I mean, you have Timothy Mozgov on the Lakers who's making more than that to sit on the bench, basically.
Yeah.
You know, because they're not playing him. They're tanking the season. But
$359,000
a game, I think. That's, you know, somebody out there like Prescott working and...
Hey, listen, but, you know
you gotta
give
credit where credit is due. He's young, man. Not our favorite.
Yeah, he gotta pay his dues, so, you know, but that check will help.
Well, talking about checks helping, you know, after Obama left office, he's been showing interest in, you know, getting into the NBA franchise. He's been telling certain sources, certain media outlets, that he doesn't mind being a part of the NBA franchise. Now, it got to the ears of Mark Cuban of the Dallas Mavericks, and he's like, listen, let's sit down, let's talk about this. I can give you 10%. Of the franchise of the Mavericks. Let's have a talk. Let's see. If you really want to do this, let's sit down. So what do you feel about Obama getting into the NBA franchise?
Getting into the Shark Tank with Cuban?
Let's
make a deal.
Yeah, it's one of those things. Like, we all know that Shark Tank scenario, that Shark Tank.
I'm with it. I love Obama. I love Mark Cuban. I think Mark Cuban is one of the best owners in basketball, in sports, period.
I
think Mark Cuban is just a dope owner. You know what I mean? And like I said, I'm all for Obama. You know, we've talked about Obama being the baller earlier. Mm-hmm. So this is right up his alley. You know, so I'm all for, I'll support that 100%. But I figure he probably might want a piece of the Bulls, if anything, though. But, you know, I'm sure he'll take the Mavs.
Yeah, that was going to be my follow-up question. If you really wanted to see Obama take part in an NBA franchise, like, which team, like...
I mean, that's his home team. I don't care.
The Bulls is his team. So, I mean, if you want to own a team, like, you would want to do the team that, you know, Jordan went and got the Bobcats because, I mean, Charlotte, you know, he played for North Carolina and everything. So, I guess, you know, North Carolina is where he spent a lot of his time. So, even though it wasn't the Bulls, it kind of made sense in a sense, you know. He played for the Wizards and owned the Wizards, so that didn't really make sense. Like,
can he come take over for James Dolan?
I wouldn't mind that, but
anything's better than Dolan at this point.
I mean, the name Obama on a franchise, I mean, that's gonna help the franchise in itself.
Exactly, you know, but he's gonna have a lot of service around.
That's why Cuban's gonna, you know, thinking about that. You know, it's a good addition, and obviously, you know, he's.
I'd like to see it, man. I'm all for it, man.
I'm interested in that. Listen, Obama,
if you want to get down on the Real Fans, Real Talk team, you know, just cut the check.
Then again, you got a lot
of
Republicans in Texas, so they might stop buying tickets.
Oh, no.
You might be right about that. But they got you know, they got a lot of other things down there, so you never know. But I mean, listen, I love it, man, to see that. Shout out to Mark Cuban, man.
Yeah, so, and shout out to Texas. This is the South by Southwest Festival this week. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of people that's been on this couch that's there now. So definitely much support, much love to everybody that's there. You know, we're glad you had a safe trip there. We want you to have a safe trip back home. Mm-hmm. Make it the best possible experience because you don't know what's going to happen from there. You always network. I always hear good things about the festival. So definitely big shout out to everyone that's there
Chambers
right now.
Chambers is down there. Yeah. Cortez is down,
yeah,
down there right now.
Yeah, it's a few people down there.
So,
like,
you know, shout out to all
to
those
name.
Guys. Yeah, shout out to everybody that's performing out there and you know, doing your thing.
And, you know, I have to go back into our hometown, into Brooklyn. You know, recently, this past Sunday, it was the Biggie night in the Barclays Center. It was amazing. It was just overall, it was great. I wasn't in attendance personally, but just being on social media, everybody on Snapchat, everybody on Instagram, they were really just on live, Instagram live. You know, that update is amazing. So definitely that's something that I got to kind of experience firsthand also, just being, just watching it through someone else. And I kind of want to just give that floor to Trip for a little bit because I really want him to go into more of it because I know he's really that Biggie advocate and I feel like I need to toss. I should have tossed this segment to you before.
Definitely. Listen, it was dope. You know, Puff, of course, is there. Miss Wallace is there,
yes.
Tiana, CJ, you know, was all there. A lot of friends and family came out, and it was dope that the Nets, because I mean, they didn't have to do that for Biggie. I mean, the Nets didn't get to Brooklyn until long after, you know, rest in peace, but long after Biggie was gone, and you know, but the fact that they decided to do it, you know, on the 20th anniversary of Big's death was just dope, you know, and you know, on top of that, which was probably the best part of it for me, was it was, you know, it was Knicks Nets game, and they beat up on Nets on Biggie's night, so that made me feel, you know, really good.
Well, the Knicks, you know, the Knicks let them have it, because for Biggie, I guess.
Listen, I mean, you tell it how you want to tell us that, man, but they still got the W. My man, Dimwitty, baby. He was out there balling.
And they,
you know,
they retired a Biggie in the rafters. I think mm-hmm. number 72.
Yes.
And I got a shout. I'm gonna have her come through. This artist who she did this life size sculpture of Biggie's head.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna get you guys. I'm gonna have some pictures of it, but we're gonna have her come through one of these days to the set to talk about it. I'll see if I can get her to bring the statue through here. But I just spoke to the curator, who's a good friend of mine, and he wants to, you know, set something up. So we're gonna probably do that within like the next couple of weeks. If we can't bring the sculpture here, because I believe it's where's it at right now? That's one of those colleges.
Film on
yeah, we'll go there and get some footage of it, and then we'll bring the sculpture back.
Transporting it will be a little bit of a pain.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just saying because that's the type of things we can do. You know, the power of real fans.
Imagine throwing that in the car, like, oh, the Biggie's alive! I told you.
Oh my God!
you gotta ride top down through Brooklyn. You know, with that in the back seat.
No red lights.
You throw
that
shotgun.
Shotgun. No. Throw him up there. Yeah, man.
Anyway.
That'd be dope.
Back to my final portion. So, you know, I have to give a special shout out to Puerto Rico. Shout out to Puerto Rico for winning the World Baseball Classic 3-1 against Dominican Republic. You know, that was the big Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico. There was a little beef.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Puerto Rico won 3-1. And it was great. So it was definitely something where, you know, Puerto Rico, shout out. You know, shout out to
both countries
because
they both got, you know,
amazing.
Some nice things to offer. But God, that's neither here nor there.
Anyway, you know, it's definitely great to just experience baseball. But the bigger thing was this whole Jennifer Lopez and A-Rod because they were both spotted there together now. You know.
Boot up.
Yeah. Now, you know, Jennifer Lopez has recently, you know, had her little rendezvous with Drake, but that just was just short lived. So now she's busy.
She's
with
a player. You said that was a booty call?
I said it was short lived.
It was short lived. I don't know what.
Maybe
I'm
it was just dating, and they realized it wasn't gonna work out, and that was it.
Okay.
You know the way social media
works. She's going out after all the young celebrities. You know,
cougar.
She's even 10 years older than A-Rod too, or something like that. But she looks good.
Now you
so
see the
whatever.
7 degrees of separation, though, right? We just talking about Puff You know, that was her boo back in the day.
Yep.
Now she's with A-Rod, and they're calling him, what is it? They calling him A-Lo? Is that what they
call it? Yeah, something like that. Or J-Rod or something.
J-Rod or A-Lo. Which one you like better?
I think A-Lo sounds
A-Lo.
Better.
A-Lo or J-Rod?
I think A-Lo sounds A-Lo? Better.
I like A-Lo too. I like A-Lo.
Okay,
we going with A-Lo. We going
that we said it here first, yeah. I guess.
I mean, so, we'll be talking about another one next week on the Rumor Mill with.
Come on, Statman, why you doing
that? I don't know if A-Lo's gonna last.
She's
like
just
that.
Jenny from the block, man.
And she's from the Bronx too.
I didn't say she's been around the block. She's from Bombers. The block. Okay, come on, man.
You guys.
I'm
you
sorry.
See?
I'm sorry. J-Lo.
This is why they can't do the Rumor Mill because you sorry. See how different
from around the block.
No, she's. I didn't say she's been around the block.
I am.
I know, but you combine
she's
the
from the block, 6 train. Okay, yeah. You know, not okay. You know what? Go ahead, Ladybug. Because I almost
now the now, right now the sources go on to say that they met through mutual friends. They didn't know each other that long. So as much as they are dating, quote unquote, they're still getting to know each other. So don't expect nothing crazy. There's gonna be no walking down the aisle, no more. You oh, know,
they just met. Obviously,
whatever happened to monogamy? Does that not exist anymore?
Anyway.
No? All right.
They're getting to know each other. They met through mutual friends. They have been seen
right
publicly in several places. These two are crazy.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
This is why you can't give these guys the room.
I'm sorry. Listen, J-Lo's still looking good at her mm-hmm. age. At 65, she still looks good. I would, you know.
I'm 50 and I know it.
Oh my God.
She works out. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Ladyboy. Go ahead.
Are you finished or are you done?
I'm both. Yeah, right. You know what? When I walked in the building, I was tired. I got on the elevator. But as soon as I sit down on the couch, it's like I get a new energy, you know? I'm sorry. Go ahead, Ladyboy.
Anyway, as always, you know I'm going to keep up with that as well as our other rumors going on. You know I have something with our Mayweather versus the World segment. You know I got that brewing. So make sure you keep up with that. And also follow me on realfansrealtalk.com.
Yep, Mayweather announced that he's out of retirement and he called out.
We were supposed to save it. Yeah, see, well, cat's out the bag. Now you gotta
save
sure
it for next week. It's recent news.
No, see, but you see, it's all right. Anyway,
she wants to do a
it's
vlog
okay.
about that later.
We're gonna do a vlog now, and now I'm gonna have Statman with me on the vlog.
Well, you gotta keep me informed on these things.
See, it's cool. It's cool. They want me on the couch earlier, guys. They've been getting your submissions. They've been getting your suggestions. They, you know, have Ladybug in the beginning.
Shout out to you, Ladybug, and the rest of the pregame. John, welcome back show this past
yes,
Wednesday.
Yes, we
show.
Are back every Wednesday, 12 noon to 3 p.m. on your radio, zonesout.net. And also, I just want to say thanks to the people here on The Bush, this web series I've been on since day one. Thank you to everybody's show,
that's
everybody.
Statman's boys.
The Bush is definitely great. So
you know him and Statman is your boy from the show. And Statman throwing it back at your party.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, they were politicking. Shout-outs to show. Shout out to POTMG, everybody there. Thank you so much for putting me on board and keeping me. And, you know, we building. They got Statman in the ears. So, you know, Real Fans, Real Talk may make a cameo. We don't know. Make sure you stay tuned.
Very possible.
They've been hitting us up. Actually, I just got an email this week from another new web series, you know. And, you know, they like what we're doing over here. So, you know, I mean, listen, we're going to keep rocking. Now, you know, we support everybody that's moving and that's working, and we're going to continue to do that. So if you guys are working, you know we're going to show you love on Real Fans, Real Talk. Either you're going to be here, we're going to play a video like we did earlier today, or whatever y'all got going on. We support, man.
Definitely. And it's about time to wrap things up on this edition of Real Fans, Real Talk. Thanks to Ladybug for coming on as usual so the fans don't get disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Trip Young. And another great episode in the books. And LeVar Ball, I'm calling you out here on Real Fans Real Talk, one-on-one. Let's do this.
And if he beats you, then me, Statman, and Ladybug get the $1 billion sneaker deal because we, you know, the three of us.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? I'm just putting that out there.
And you got to pay Trip Young his quarter.
Exactly. Oh. Recognize who you're dealing with.
Exactly. Thanks for joining us on Real Fans Real Talk. We'll see you next time, everyone.
Good night.
Good night. RealFansRealTalk.com. Check it out.
Face facts. realfansrealtalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan, I get all my facts from my bro Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Realfansrealtalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
Well, log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only...